a morning in April of 2010, a 31-year-old Guatemalan immigrant by the name of Hugo Talayox was walking on a street in Queens. Streets were familiar to him. New York had become his adopted home. He found day work as he could, too many nights he was left to sleep on those streets. But he knew his way around, and that morning, as the city was beginning to wake up and people were beginning to be about their way, he happened to witness a woman being attacked by another man. And clearly, wanting to stop the attack, Talayox interceded and jumped in to try to spare her. In so doing, he himself was attacked by her assailant. She seized the opportunity to get away from her assailant and took off running. The assailant stabbed Talayox, and he took off in the other direction. And Talayox stumbled a few steps before falling on the sidewalk of that New York street. For 1 hour and 20 minutes, New Yorkers walked by Hugo Talayox on that sidewalk. Well, most of them walked by. One actually stopped and kind of turned him over to see what was going on with him and then kept walking. Another, fascinated by all of this, whipped out his cell phone to take a picture of him. And then he too kept walking. By the time someone actually decided to call the police, and the police would arrive, it was too late. And Hugo Talayox had died. This story, if you don't happen to recall it, fascinated our nation. Headlines everywhere, people wondering, how could something like this happen? The only reason that we even know that it happened was because there happened to be a surveillance camera mounted on a building in front of this scene, and the entire hour and 20 minutes was recorded on that surveillance camera. And there, kind of like Adam and Eve laid bare before God, humanity was laid bare. In its inability to come to the aid of a man who had risked his life coming to the aid of someone else. Now, everybody had lots of questions, from reporters to theologians to psychologists to people who worked with immigrants. Everybody had lots of questions about how this could happen, and everybody wanted to throw in their 2 cents. For why it happened the way it did. Folks who worked with immigrants said, well, people who are immigrants themselves might have seen him and might have been so afraid of the police that they didn't want to get involved. Psychologists thought, well, maybe New Yorkers have become so numb to seeing drunk homeless folks lying on the street that it really just didn't faze them, and they thought he was really okay and just needed to sleep it off. And then there was the last category. The last category was, so many people saw him that surely as they all rushed by on their way to work and school and the gym and breakfast and all the places they were going, surely somebody thought that somebody else would be the one to call the police and get help for him. Because surely somebody else sees this. But however it unfolded, there he was, lying on a sidewalk, a good Samaritan himself, with no one to come to his aid. And then we, as people of God, begin asking ourselves some questions like, how does that happen? What would we do? Does Scripture inform us in any way to help us begin to process what happened on that street that morning? Well, yes, Scripture does inform us in lots of ways, right? We can sit and nod and acknowledge Scripture informs us in lots of ways. Even before those people called Israel would make it to the Promised Land, they'd already gotten commandments from God about loving God and caring for one another. Six of those first 10 commandments were all about living in right relationship with one another, honoring parents and living faithfully with our spouses, not lying, not coveting or stealing that which doesn't belong to us, not killing each other. All those things telling us about right relationship. No fewer than a dozen times in Exodus, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy are the people called Israel told how it is that they are to provide for the least of these among them. If you see the widow and the alien and the orphan, you are to care for them. Why are you to care for them? You are to care for them because God took care of you when you were enslaved and suffering. In the words that we might use today, you are to pay that forward. You were cared for. Now you are to care for everyone else. Scripture is filled with the commandment to us to love and serve our God and one another. What went wrong that day? We turn to our gospel lesson this morning from Luke, and we see a lawyer. I used to be one of those. We see a lawyer asking Jesus what he should do in order to inherit eternal life. And Jesus is thinking, you're a lawyer. Don't you know this? Surely you know this. And the lawyer responds back and says, yes, we're to love God and we're to love neighbor as ourselves. And Jesus is like, okay, you know. You got it. Do it. Just do it and all will be well. And then the lawyer, as we're told in the text, is seeking to justify himself, presses farther to ask, and who is my neighbor? And we're wondering as he asks this question, at least I'm wondering, as he asks that question, is it that he already knows that he is struggling so deeply within himself to love somebody that he can't love, that he's hoping Jesus is going to give him a cover and an out? That Jesus is going to excuse him, that Jesus is going to say, well, that person that you're struggling so much with, that's really not your neighbor, don't worry about it. But instead, Jesus comes back with the most unlikely of unlikely stories. A man who's been beaten by robbers and left to die on the side of a busy road. two holy men walk by and they cross and pass on the other side. This isn't how that story is supposed to go, is it? The two holy men are not supposed to walk away, but the two holy men walk away. And then there is a Samaritan. Context is everything. Jesus is telling this story in the Galilee, probably among a 98, 99% Jewish audience. There may be a Gentile or two on the fringes. A Samaritan is a half-breed. When the Jews have been exiled and they go and they live in all of the places where they go, well, those Jews who decided to intermarry with Assyrians, because you know they weren't supposed to do that, now they're no longer good Jews because they have intermarried with people who weren't Jews. And so their descendants, these half-breeds, are people upon whom the Jewish community looks with great contempt. So of all of the people for Jesus to tell this story and lift as someone who does something that might be emulated, a Samaritan is not the one. This is not the way this story is supposed to play out. But it does. It's the Samaritan, the one who doesn't look like the injured man, the one whose dialect is probably different from that of the injured man, the one who probably has the most to fear just because the injured man might reject him. It's the Samaritan who stops, who is moved with pity, who takes the injured man and bandages his wounds and gets him off this dangerous road so that nothing else can happen to him. It's the Samaritan. It's the Samaritan whose actions Jesus tells this lawyer to emulate. Go and do likewise. Go and show mercy as he has shown mercy. We are called today to go and do likewise. We are called today to go and show mercy. We are called to go in the places where we are least expected to show up, among the people who least expect to see us. And no, we may not look like them, our dialect may not be the same, we may not dress like them, our behaviors may not be their behaviors, but we are called to show up in those unexpected places and to show mercy. We are called to take risk. We are called to open our hearts and our lives to those who need us and to bandage the wounds of the injured. We are called to shelter the homeless, to demand justice for the persecuted, to walk alongside the grieving and the hurt, to show the light of Christ to the lost. We are called to go and do likewise. The harvests are plentiful. Our opportunities too numerous to count. count. Where will we go this day? Who among God's people will we serve? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.